to learn how to serve.
Thank you all for coming here on a Sunday afternoon. My name is Charles Beard. I'm a parishioner here. Welcome to people both from St. Mary's and from elsewhere. I'm going to moderate this panel discussion, Refugee Restrictions, Muslim Stories, and the Catholic Response. Venerable Fulton Sheen once said, "The Catholic must approach the world with a Bible in one hand and a newspaper in the other." In other words, we must look at the world through the lens of the gospel, and the gospel then informs us how to engage the world. This panel discussion is an attempt to do just that. We want to accomplish two things today. First, we're going to discuss what's happening in our community in Tulsa and in our country with regard to refugees and immigrants, particularly from the Muslim majority world. Second, we will talk about how the Catholic Church has responded to these issues institutionally and what we as individual Christians can do about it. Before we begin, I'd like to say a few words about the title of our event. Again, we decided to call it Refugee Restrictions, Muslim Stories, and the Catholic Response. I just want to break down each part of that title. First, Refugee Restrictions. Obviously, the immediate impetus for holding this event was the president's executive order to temporarily halt refugee admissions into the United States for a few months, and all immigrant and non-immigrant travel from 7 Muslim-majority countries. The news moves faster than we do in the church, so that order is now on hold as people fight out its legality in court. Nevertheless, there are refugees in Tulsa, and our diocese has a role in settling many of them. We thought it was important to discuss what our church does and how recent events have affected our work. Second, Muslim stories. Because of the current climate, it's easy to see refugees, immigrants, Muslims, pick your group, as issues rather than persons. But Christ tells us in Matthew's gospel that he is the stranger whom we welcome or don't welcome. It's impossible to welcome the stranger if we don't get to know him to see what he or she needs. For that reason, we've invited representatives of the Muslim community in Tulsa to talk about their experience, hopes, dreams, struggles in Tulsa. And finally, the Catholic response. We called it the Catholic response because this is not a political event. We are here for the gospel. We're not here to promote or denounce a particular politician or policy. Bearing that in mind, I'd like to quote from part of what the Second Vatican Council says about the church's relationship with Muslims. Quoting now, "Since in the course of centuries, not a few quarrels and hostilities have arisen between Christians and Muslims, this sacred synod," meaning the fathers of Vatican II, "urges all to forget the past and work sincerely for mutual understanding and to preserve as well as promote together for the benefit of all mankind, social justice and moral welfare, as well as peace and freedom." I hope this event will be a step toward doing just that. In the first hour, each of the panelists here will tell us a bit about where things stand from their perspective, and I will ask questions to keep the conversation moving. We'll take a quick break after that, and the whole second hour will be questions and answers from you guys. If you have questions, there are note cards. Raise your hand and someone will bring you a note card. And just write it down, hand it back. There's collection plates, which I find very funny. And put it in there, and they will give them to me, and I will get through as many questions as I possibly can. One note before I introduce the panelists. If you need to use the restroom, go turn out of this room, go left, up the ramp, you'll run into it. Or turn right, go through the other double doors, and then turn left, and you'll run into it. So with that, I am pleased to introduce our panelists. Starting closest to me, Mayor Rodger Randle served in the Oklahoma Senate from 1972 to 1988, and is mayor of Tulsa from 1988 to 1992. He is now professor at the Graduate College at OU here in Tulsa, and serves as director for studies in democracy and culture. Next to him is Deacon Kevin Sartorius, who is the executive director of Catholic Charities in Tulsa, has been since 2004. He led the expansion of Catholic Charities into what it is today. He was ordained a deacon in 2011 and serves at Holy Family Cathedral downtown Tulsa. Next to him is Amber Knecht, another representative of Catholic Charities. She is the Director of Immigrant and Refugee Services. In that capacity, she helps people from asylum seekers to green card holders to human trafficking victims get or maintain legal status in the United States. Before coming to Catholic Charities in 2012, she was a refugee caseworker for the YWCA and worked at Human Supports of Idaho. Next to her, Aliye Shimi is a native Tulsan, graduate of Union High School. I just realized that I went to her sister's graduation at Union. She is an associate director of Tulsa Metropolitan Ministry, an ecumenical and interfaith organization that promotes religious understanding. She is also a member of the Islamic Society of Tulsa, and in that capacity helps get refugees and other immigrants settled and start a new life in the United States. We also have a very special guest. Muhammad has been in the United States for just 3 months. He is a native of Afghanistan. He has to get to work after this, so I've asked him to speak first. And so if Muhammad could come up here, and if you could tell us a little bit about how you came to the United States and how you're finding it here. So thank you very much.
I was before in Afghanistan. I came here like 3 months ago. My life is better to Afghanistan to here. I like it, Oklahoma, grateful, I live in there. My children, my wife, I am liking to another state in grateful, Oklahoma.
Can you tell us how you came to the United States?
You know, like I working from army to 10 years from working from army. They want to drop it on me to here to another state. They want to help me because my life is danger to another. My life is danger to Afghanistan. They want to kill my children, my wife. Also, they want to kill me while you help to army people. That's why I want to come to another state. I like so much. I like them. I very, very like it, American people. Them. My children is very happy to hear. That's why I want to come to another state.
Thank you. So, I'm going to ask each of our panelists an opening question. Let's start with you, Mayor Randle. In an era of fake news and alternative facts, how do citizens become or stay informed, particularly when we don't live lives kind of surrounded by public policy?
That's a very pertinent question because getting accurate information is not easy. And so that's why I think it is really worthwhile to pay to get a credible news source. So I subscribe to 3 myself, which is probably more than one needs to do. But to get national and international news, we're not going to get it, sadly, with the local paper because it doesn't devote much space to that. So you really are better off to get a subscription to the New York Times or to another publication that is a credible source. And then you can find out a lot more detail about what's going on. If you worry about the balance of the New York Times or the Washington Post or something, you've got lots of sources that give you counter viewpoints. But so many sources that people use today are places where we find opinions. What we need is information. What we need is facts. And then we can develop an opinion later based on those facts. So unfortunately, I think today the only way to really be informed is to get some out-of-town source for news. You know, there are, through the Catholic Church, different sources. There are lots of different places that you can get things. But for day-to-day news, probably we're going to have to pay just as we pay to get our local newspaper.
Thank you, Mayor. Deacon Kevin, if we could step back a little bit from kind of where we are as a nation, can you tell us a little bit about what the church teaches on matters like of, like immigration, refugees, etc.?
How much time do we have?
How much do you need?
No, I'll keep it brief. Really, if you were to summarize it into just a few points, if you were to say, what does the church teach on immigration? Catholic social teaching has kind of a one-pager that would provide like three different elements. The first element is that a nation has a right to control who comes into it. Otherwise, it wouldn't really be a nation. And so it is allowable, even it's a responsibility of government, to control its borders. That is recognized by the Catholic Church. The second very brief point that would be mentioned there is that people, families, individuals, have a right to peace. They have a right to be able to work so that they can earn money and pay for food and send their children to school and to keep them in a home. This is something that we almost take for granted in this country. But it's not just for Americans, it's for every person. And so now you potentially have two competing elements. One is that a country can control its borders, and a people, if they're in a place where there is no peace, there's war, and wants to move, how do you then deal with this intersection? And so the third point of Catholic social teaching is that a country, having established its borders and being able to protect its people, should in charity welcome the stranger when they're able to do so. To let families, let individuals who are in harm's way, who are not combatants, leave that area where they're at risk and come to an area where they can live in peace. And if they're a peace-loving people, if they're interested in raising their family and building a home and educating their children and getting a job, then most countries would want to welcome them, because that's what builds up a society. And so you have those three points: protect the border, live in peace, and accept people when they can't live in peace. And that kind of summarizes the three points of Catholic social teaching in about as tight a nutshell as I can.
That's great. and there's a lot of different viewpoints kind of within those broad parameters.
Right, and so there we could go into the fact that there are different ways of interpreting that. And there are perhaps at times conflict even within the church as to how it should be carried out. So that's a very broad outline of Catholic social teaching. How you implement it today, or during World War II, or in 20 years, is something for each of us as members of the body of Christ to wrestle with. But hopefully to keep all three of those points in balance, and to understand that that's who we are as a Catholic people.
Thank you, Deacon. Amber, can you tell us about what Catholic Charities does to implement Catholic social teaching? Tell us about immigration, refugee services, and what y'all do.
Yes. So I think in order for you to fully understand, can you guys hear me okay? For you to fully understand what Catholic Charities does, how about now? For you to fully understand what Catholic Charities is doing, I think that it would be best if I describe the larger picture and then where Catholic Charities fits into that piece. So currently, as of today, there are approximately 65 million displaced persons in the world due to war, violence, and persecution. Of those 65 million, 23 million approximately fit the definition of a refugee. Now, of those 23 million, only 2% are deemed worthy for resettlement. So you're probably wondering, well, how did they get from 23 to 2% of that? So UNHCR is working with different countries overseas to vet people. And so their first priority is not resettlement. Their first priority is to voluntarily repatriate a person back to their native country. So if that person has fled to a neighboring country due to war, they work with that country, that unstable country, to regain stability in the region so the people who have fled can return home. If that doesn't work, they then look to the country where the person has fled, and they try to work with the country to get that person integrated into the local region. So Can you provide citizenship to this person who's fled their country? If that doesn't work, then they look at resettlement. So the UNHCR is working with the country a person has fled from, a country the person has fled to, and the prospective country that is willing to take the refugee. So in terms of the United States government has the State Department, and in the State Department there's a branch called the Bureau of Population, Refugees, and Migration. They work and coordinate with UNHCR in overseas areas to process refugees that are seeking asylum in the United States. So when a person has gone through security clearances, medical clearances, interviews, and they're ready for travel to the United States, UNHCR works hand in hand with the State Department, and they vet these people through the CIA, the FBI, the Department of Homeland Security. And then when that person is ready for travel, they work with 9 national resettlement agencies. So if you think of refugee resettlement in terms of an organizational chart, you have PRN, which is the federal government, and then 9 national resettlement agencies that work directly with the State Department. So in terms of the Catholic network, one of the 9 national resettlement agencies is the USCCB, United States Conference of Catholic Bishops. So Catholic Charities here in Tulsa is an affiliate office of that agency. So each of the 9 national agencies have their own networks, and in the Catholic network, there are approximately 110 offices around the United States that resettle refugees. So when a person is fit for travel and they've gotten all of their documents in place, and it's important to note a refugee is not an illegal immigrant or an alien, they are processed overseas. They are invited and cleared by the United States government to come into the country, and they have all of their legal documentation when they arrive into the United States. That process is a very time-consuming process, and it varies depending on what country they're coming from. So in urgent situations, you can see that people are moving more quickly, and by quickly, I mean 2 to 3 years. And in other places, like Africa, you see people are in refugee camps for 20 to 30 years before they're permitted to enter the United States. So it's not an overnight process, and it's a very lengthy process. Most of our families that we receive here in Tulsa have been in the process for 5 to 10 years, some longer depending on what country they're coming from. So once a refugee is ready for travel, they work with the State Department, they work with the Catholics, and then we get notified that a family has a relative or a friend already residing here in Tulsa and that they would like to be resettled in our community. And then that kind of starts the process at a local level. We set up an apartment if they need one, we furnish it, we greet them at the airport, we take them to their home, we provide cultural orientations. Italy Camp, who's a member of your parish, is our lovely cultural orientation provider. We take them to get enrolled in school, they go to the health department, medical screenings, home visit forms, and so it's a very large process, but at a local level, we're really providing intensive case management for 3 months to get these people stabilized, to get them transitioned into American life, and to get them familiar with our customs and culture.
Great, thank you.
Sorry, I could go on and on. That was like really condensed and summarized.
Yeah,
she
often does.
So many people have that question.
Catholic Church has just welcomed a large group of folks into the United States. Where primarily were they from?
Yes, so this week, we had originally, prior to the executive order, we had approximately 30 individuals that were booked who come into Tulsa throughout February, and their flights all got canceled as a result of the executive order. And then when the federal judge overturn that executive order. The State Department frantically tried to rebook everybody that was canceled. And so this week we had 30 approximately individuals from Burma and Russia, Ukraine, all Christians, and all very, very happy to be here.
Thank you. Aliye, can you tell us about what the Muslim community does to resettle refugees, immigrants, acclimate them to the United States, and how the current climate has affected them?
Sure. So, can you all hear me okay?
That's all I can give you.
I'm sorry. I can project. How about that?
Please don't move the microphone.
Okay. I'll press his voice. Okay. All right. So, within the Muslim community, we have a couple of organizations that help. Within our mosque, which is the only mosque here in Tulsa, it's the Islamic Society of Tulsa, we have a food pantry that they help with as far as helping them gain all of their access to food. And then we have a little over 400 physicians within our congregation here in Tulsa. And so we have a free clinic, and they're able to provide them with medical services. And then we also have a, I don't like to call it a shelter, I call it transitional housing for battered women and children, it's an Australian foundation that was founded in 2008. And so we're able to take in families there as well to be able to help them with housing. And so they say sometimes 6 months to a year until they're able to be stable. We help, I mean, just like Catholic Charities helps them, help them get a driver's license, help them get employment, you know, education, whatever it is that we can help them with. And then once they're able to be on their feet, then we help them transition out into a different apartment. We have a few members who own different apartment complexes as well, and they've allotted some of their housing within their apartment complexes for us to be able to do that. And they'll take the furniture with them. We have some members in our congregation who own car lots, and so they'll donate vehicles as well. And so those are just some of the steps that we take to help them, just in a nutshell, as far as helping those who have come in as immigrants or as refugees. I can't tell you how much we appreciate all the services that Catholic Charities provides for the individuals who are coming in. So within the larger community, just to give you some of the numbers, we have roughly 20,000 Muslims here in Tulsa. And they range from at least 50 different countries and 5 Native American tribes. So we have a very, very, very diverse congregation. There are people like me who are first generation. My parents immigrated here from Turkey in 1975. I had an uncle here who had been here since 1964. So 8 of my family members came from Germany. And they came to Staten Island on the QE2. And then they bought a Winnebago and drove to Tulsa. And they've been in Tulsa ever since, right? And I was the first Tulsan in my family to be born here in 1977. And so we have a decent sized immigrant population here, some first gen, some second, third, fourth gen. And so with regards to all of this new legislation or new executive orders and things like that that are going on, of course, there's a lot of fear within our community. Some of those who are immigrants, of course, a lot more fear for them, but we're getting word that even the American citizens are having issues traveling in and out with regards to being detained, with regards to having their private information, their cell phones taken away, things like that, being questioned.
Would that be because of dress or?
If they're identifiably Muslim, right? So a lot of people have canceled trips. Whether they're family members coming in or people going out. A lot of people who had family members out just frantically tried to get their family members in, even if they are green card holders and permanent residents here in the United States. Many, many people in the community have been seeking advice from different immigration lawyers, just trying to see what it is that they can do. And we were so blessed and proud of our Mayor J.T. Bynum and our police department have come out and said that, you know, they are not going to be knocking down doors just to be checking immigration statuses, right? And so for individuals in the immigrant population, not just ours, but across the board in Tulsa, for them not to be afraid to be able to contact the law enforcement in case they need law enforcement for any reason. And so we've been blessed here in Tulsa that our community is a pretty strong community. Some of our legislatures, you know, Catholic Charities and other organizations like TMM, to be able to work together to try and put that fear, bring that level of fear down a little bit. and try and get some normalcy in the lives of the immigrants here.
Have there been any specific incidents targeting Muslims or immigrants that, that anybody on the panel has been aware of?
Speak up, please.
Yeah. Okay.
Talking to the mic.
Is this better?
Yes.
Hello.
Can you get a speaker for her, please?
Sorry.
I'm not sure. Aliye, maybe perhaps you could come up here at some point. I don't know.
Sure.
Have there been any specific incidents targeting Muslims, refugees, immigrants, pick your group, that anybody on the panel is aware of that we might respond to?
Is this other than the executive order?
Yes.
I would say my experience specifically with our Muslim families that we resettle in Tulsa, they typically have a harder time integrating into our community, especially the Muslim women, because they're often wearing hijabs. I've had several incidences where I've been called by frantic clients saying they were harassed while they were walking down the street to the grocery store, where people have pulled up to them and shouted profanity and told them to go back to where they came from. And so we at Catholic Charities understand that this is happening in our community, and we really try to attend events like this to spread the word that the people that we are resettling are in fact here for a better life and to live out the American dream. And we provide extra assistance to those families and support when they're experiencing those kinds of incidences.
If I could jump in there and say that I just don't really understand the difficulty with a hijab. It's, what would you call it, headwear, headdress, what would you call it? Mm-hmm. It really, if we were to change that, maybe in this case to a black, you would look like a Catholic nun. And Catholic nuns walk around with the same thing on. And why do people give?
My wife wears one during Mass.
Well, it's so very similar to my it. Wife does as well. Yeah. She wears a veil at Mass, and the Blessed Virgin Mary in every photograph you'll ever see, or every painting you'll ever see, even the photographs, if you can. In every painting you'll see, she's wearing a veil over her head. This is a sign giving glory to God. It's not something that should be feared. I don't really understand why that's such an issue, but it is something that people will single somebody out and pick on them just to be a bully, and I don't like that at all.
On a smaller scale, I know of cases where people have been verbally attacked for speaking another language, you know, as if it were not possible for a native-born Oklahoman to speak another language.
It's pretty difficult.
Just a comment on what the deacon said. In fact, I was sitting several years ago in an OSU class, and my professor asked, what would be the difference between Aliyah, who's sitting here in a hijab, and a nun who is sitting next to her? And one of my classmates said, well, one's a holy woman and the other one's a terrorist. So, you know, that is,
which was which?
Yeah, exactly. I say that to you, and I know we'll laugh about it, but unfortunately, the stigma that our media and the fear that we hear, this fear-mongering that we hear, you know, demonizes a person such as myself for trying to be more devout. I wasn't born covered, right? And I, in fact, was married for 10 years and had 4 children before I decided, and that key word, decided, because it is my choice to put on a hijab whenever I choose and if I choose to be more devout. So that is a key fact that a lot of people don't understand because of all this rhetoric that we hear. And prior to me covering, nobody ever pegged me for a Muslim, unless if I came out and said, I am a Muslim, right? Nobody ever pegged me for one. So I really didn't have a lot of discrimination against me prior to that. Once I started covering, on a few occasions I've been attacked. On a few occasions, incidents have happened with my children. You know, things have happened. Shortly after 9/11, my mother, who's a frail little old lady, was slammed to the ground at Sam's on Sunday First and Mingo and screamed and yelled at with profanities and expletives. For her to go back to her country and wherever she came from because she was the terrorist. And so that, you know, and we deal with those type of issues. I can tell you within this year, one of our dear friends who is a neighbor who lives on the street behind mine was getting out of his driveway to go pick up his wife at 10:30 at night from the airport, and a vehicle pulled up behind his vehicle. As he was backing out of his driveway, four guys jumped out of their car, jumped into his car, beat the snot out of him, and somehow he was able to, you know, fend off a little bit, and they then jumped back into their car, and they were young individuals, and then they left, but we did not find out until the next day. We urged him to call law enforcement. We urged him to make a report, and he was so afraid. He said, what's to stop them from coming back and finishing off the job if I say anything? About 8 months prior to that, we had a lady who was speaking Lebanese, and she is not veiled. She was just speaking Arabic. She just happened to be speaking Arabic. And she was walking into a Quick Trip, and some guy came and cold clocked her, knocked her out, fractured her cheekbone, and she woke up in an ambulance. And she did not file a report and did not want to press any charges when the police officers came to speak with her in the hospital, because again, she was petrified that there would be retribution. And so I can't express to you how difficult it is for an immigrant population to be able to deal with something like this. So I commend anybody that stands up for immigrants. Whenever you hear somebody belittling them, or if you see anything going on, I can't express to you how much we would appreciate it if you would be able to stand up and say something or call somebody. I can't tell you how many times I've been at the grocery store or at the bank or somebody, and somebody's baffled that that English actually just came out of my mouth, right? And so they look at me and they speak, yeah, exactly. They look at me, they speak really loud and really slow, thinking that I can't speak English. And, you know, granted, English is my second language. I speak three languages fluently, Arabic, Turkish, and English fluently. But, you know, it's baffling. It is truly baffling.
Thank you for saying that.
Sure.
And it's important to note that this many of these discrimination issues that you bring up have affected the Arabic-speaking Christians in this town as well.
Of course.
I recall right after 9/11, I was attending the Maronite Church, which is a Lebanese Christian community, and they had planned the Lebanon Fest, just the church fundraiser, you know, and they moved it indoors because they didn't want the little old ladies speaking Arabic in public. They were afraid. And that's really a shame.
Well, we can talk about, I mean, just what happened just this past summer with the Jabara family. I'm sure you all heard about it in the news. Haifa Jabara happens to be one of my dear friends, and she's their Lebanese Orthodox family, right? And you guys heard all over the news about Stanley Majors, their neighbor, who referred to them as filthy Muslims and all these other things, ran over the mother in September, tried to kill her with vehicular manslaughter. Didn't succeed, thank goodness. She recovered from that after months and months being in the hospital. And then, that was in September, and then he was released in May of 2015. Even though there was protective orders against him, he came right back to the house right next door to them, and then in the summer, shot and killed their son at their front door. And they're a Christian family, right? Because they spoke with a thick Lebanese accent, they were filthy Muslims, according to him. So I can't express enough for you all to just meet somebody that's different from you. Just smile. Ask them how their day is. You know, it is so important. I just can't tell you how important that is.
Thank you. Bearing that in mind, what my next question is, what can we as individuals do to counter discrimination, et cetera? That we might see. Aliye brings up a great idea of just saying hello. But are there any other steps that we could take?
I certainly feel that we need to be very focused on who we are as Catholics, this is a Catholic audience, and what we're called to do. In Catholic social teaching, the primary point of Catholic social teaching is dignity. And from that, you have other terms that flow from that, solidarity and common good, and you know, you could go on through a whole long list. But that everything flows from dignity. We have to see every single person as who they were created to be. They were created in the image and likeness of God, the Imago Dei. And if we can focus on seeing God in that other person, most of the other attributes kind of start to fall away. The fear that comes from a young person seeing an old person and not knowing how to act, or the fear that comes from an old person seeing a group of young people and being fearful, or of someone who's white seeing someone that's black, or someone who's straight seeing someone who's gay, or, I mean, you could go down the list and choose any of 1,000 attributes and say, this divides me from that person. Or you could go down that whole list of attributes and say, those are all secondary to the fact that this person was made in the image and likeness of God. And if that becomes the core of who they are as a person, and we can see God in them, then all the other attributes are really pretty minor in comparison. And a lot of that fear starts to dissipate. Now, in every single case, should there never be any fear? Well, that was where it was before the fall of man. It is not now, because we've experienced the fall. And so we have to be prudent, but we should not slide into hysteria, because that's where the country has led us. And I think oftentimes media of all different types on all of those different attributes will seek to try and find what divides us instead of what unites us. And if we get into that, then we become prone to treating somebody in an inhumane way. We do not see God in them, and then we start to act based on that. That's a huge mistake. We must be Catholics first and always, and Americans second. And I'm not saying that because I'm not patriotic. I'm incredibly patriotic. And this is the greatest country on earth, and that's why so many people want to come here. But the Catholic experience is a little bit different than the American experience. Even if we look at our gospel reading from today, we will have a different message in our gospel reading from Matthew chapter 5 today than what the public, what our general society speaks about all of these issues. And so we have to take it to heart and risk a little bit, and in so doing, teach others that it's okay to love. It's okay to see God in another person. I'm on a soapbox.
So keep going.
No, no.
Mayor Randle.
I just want to make some observations related to that. You know, it's important to recognize where we are. We're in Oklahoma. And we're in a place that has had historically very little experience with people who were different from us. The stories that we were hearing earlier are stories that reflect what for many people is a climate of fear that exists here. People are acting out the fears that they have of folks that are different. And it's interesting, when you look around the country, in those places with the most diversity, there is the least fear of the effects of diversity. It is where there isn't any diversity that our imaginations get carried away with the terrible things that are going to happen to us as a result of that. So, you know, first thing to remember is that on one level, we very much need to work build the kind of bridges that give us personal contact, give people in the community personal contact with folks that are different, so that they have the experience of seeing that human beings are human beings, however they may be different on the outside. It's also important to recognize we live in a place where, I'll just be blunt about my observations on things here. We live in a place where there is a lot of exploitation for political purposes of these fears. And so we want to put the Ten Commandments in marble on the grounds of the state capitol. But we don't want to put the Ten Commandments into the law books, because that might discomfort someone. And so we use, some use, Christian nation as a kind of code for rejection of the others and the creation of fear.
Which is not a Christian message.
But the problem that we have is that we've got, I'm reluctant to be so blunt, but let me continue here. We live in a place with a lot of slow readers, and so they have They have started the Bible, but they haven't got past the Old Testament. And so the message that Jesus has given in the New Testament is one that is so difficult to accept that people exploit the easiness of the old ways before the teachings of Jesus. And so we see that. And so what I think we have an obligation to do, because ignorance and fear makes itself heard. And so we need to make, whether through the Catholic Church or the church to which I belong, or whatever religious institution to which we belong, or maybe no religious institution, we have to make being charitable in a broad way something that is also heard. And so in order to be heard as reasonable, maybe we have to sometimes speak in unreasonable ways in order to be loud enough to be heard as an offset to the appeals to ignorance and fear. And so we have two obligations. One is on a personal level and a community level, to create the opportunities for people to know each other as different. And you know, we're here at a Roman Catholic church. It wasn't very long ago, I need to remind you, that Roman Catholics were viewed with great suspicion by people in this community. They were a rejected and set aside part of the community. That's not the case today. But it's important to remember from where we all came. We think back to the founding of this new land. We think of the pilgrims getting off the boat at Plymouth Rock. And of course, the pilgrims, we need to remember, were refugees from a religious situation that they found intolerable in England at the time. And so from the very beginning of our country, we look at this story of the immigrants. Of course, the pilgrims were the first wave. The pilgrims were accepted with Christian charity by the non-Christian Indians. They were rewarded, the Indians were rewarded with extermination and forced removal so that the Christians could have the better farmland and so forth. So we need to put a lot of these things in context. It's so easy for us to put ourselves on a high pillar. We came here legally. Well, we didn't get this land we're on legally, did we? We got it by the power of the military, taking it from those to whom it belonged. So you know, the first thing we need to do is have a little humility about who we are. And then secondly, to recognize what our obligation is as Christians or in whatever religious tradition from which we come. Anyway, we need to work within the community, but we need to also recognize that there is an important and powerful public policy dimension to how we handle kinds of situations that we've got, where people in power, fortunately not at our city hall, but where people in power affirm fear and ignorance, then fear and ignorance will flourish. And so we need to make sure that our institutions of government, which are our collective institutions as a community, are used to affirm the values of this country and not baser impulses.
Yeah, I just wanted to reiterate that our motto at TMM is we don't have to believe alike to love alike. that we don't all have to agree on every single topic. We are never going to agree on every single topic. My brother, who's a lieutenant commander in the U.S. Navy, voted for President Trump, you know, and some of my other family members have as well. I have Catholics in my family. I have atheists in my family. I have agnostics in my family. I have Muslims in my family. I have secular people in my family. So we love each other, and just because one or two or three people have different views, we're not going to pick those topics to fight over, right? We need to strengthen ourselves by loving thy neighbor as Jesus taught, right? And so I can't tell you how many times I've seen pictures of my friends or my neighbors. One will have, you know, a female will have a hijab on, and then another young lady will come over in a Trump shirt, and they've brought each other cake or something like that. And so I'm not trying to make this political. I'm just trying to explain to you that we don't have to agree on everything to be able to know that we're all human beings and that we are living together. And to be able to make this nation a great nation, that's what it is for us to be able to learn about one another and just be neighbors, be neighborly. That's all it takes. And so I encourage you to, somebody that's different from you, somebody that you don't know, just to meet them and talk to them and just, you know, have coffee. And I promise you it'll go well. I promise you it'll go well. So.
Who doesn't like coffee?
That's right.
So thank you all. We've got some really excellent questions. We're going to get through as many of them as we possibly can. We're going to do speed Q&A. To start off with, where in Tulsa can I go to meet people from other countries and have coffee with them?
We have a representative here today from Tulsa Global Alliance.
Bob. Can you raise your hand? I saw Bob somewhere.
Stand,
where's Bob at?
Maybe Bob got offended by my speech and my speech. But one good organization is Tulsa Global Alliance. You can look it up online. There's a lot of things with a lot of different countries. There are other organizations. You used to work with YWCA, right? You know, YWCA does really wonderful work in this community and expanding and bringing things together. So there are lots of good places to begin.
Student union over at Tulsa University.
I'm sorry, one more time?
The University of Tulsa Student Union.
Oh, yes.
Hang there for 10 minutes.
Many more students are to you.
I'd also like to say, at Catholic Charities, because we do resettle 350 refugees annually, we are always looking for additional support for our families. Most of our families arrive with two suitcases with all of their worldly belongings in them. And then they arrive here and they have to manage ways to get to doctor appointments or to get to their employer. And so we're always looking for families to sponsor our families that we are currently aiding. And so if you are interested, we do have an online application process if you're wanting to volunteer. And it's not just within our refugee program. We have our immigration department and 13 other programs at Catholic Charities an individual could volunteer in and have access to immigrants here in Tulsa.
Great, thank you. On a very different note, thanks. Why have moderate Muslims not expunged Islam of radical jihadists?
You gotta love this one, right? I love this question. Just like any other faith, everybody has their handful of cuckoos, right? And I apologize, but that's what I call them. I get asked this question quite frequently, why do you guys support ISIS? And at which I say, why do you guys support the KKK? And then they say, well, KKK is not a Christian organization. And I say, I beg to differ. When they marched 35,000 strong down Pennsylvania Avenue with 70-foot-tall crosses and a cross on every single hood, you tell me how that's not a Christian organization. Now, luckily, I happen to know the teachings of Jesus Christ, and I know that that organization has nothing to do with Christianity or the teachings of Christ, but you can't tell me that it's not a quote-unquote Christian organization. You know, we can go on and on about all these other, you know, faiths who have their cuckoos, as I call them. And so
we talk until we're blue in the face. Anytime an attack, we are constantly out in the media, talking to schools, to churches, everywhere. But, you know, with the media, if it bleeds, it leads, right? And so the only time they're going to put a Muslim in the media that you're going to see is if there's something majorly going on, like when we had the ban, right? And so that entire 2 weeks that the ban was announced and the week after, I was constantly in the media. So if people are going la, 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 there's not much I can do about that, right? And so my faith doesn't teach any of those twisted things, just like Christianity or Judaism or Hindu or, you know, any of those other faiths do as well. So I would hope that people would understand that.
Let me add just a quick thing. I spent some time a year or so ago with a fellow who was a soldier and was fighting extremists, and the vehicle in which he was in was blown up. Everybody was killed except for him, and he was badly wounded. He was a Muslim. He was a Pakistani soldier, not an American soldier. And so lots of people in Muslim countries are on the front line of fighting the extremists. I won't repeat all that, but to summarize, lots of people in Muslim majority countries are on the front line of fighting Muslim extremists. You know, there is an ignorance on our part to sort of imagine that there is an acceptance or an indifference or whatever. You know, read the facts and you'll see that it's different from that.
Yeah. I mean, ISIS just had an attack in Pakistan earlier this week. 92 people lost their lives. How many of you all heard of that in the mainstream media? Right? A few hands went up. Yes. Like I mentioned before, my brother is a lieutenant commander in this Navy, in the United States Navy. He gave up his Turkish citizenship so he can serve our country, right? And that though he wasn't born here, I was born here, he was not born here, but and he was naturalized in 1988 to be a U.S. citizen. And so for people to think that Muslims are not on the front lines fighting it, quite literally on the front lines fighting it, is just ludicrous.
Yeah, I kind of want to reiterate that. Muhammad, if you could understand what he was trying to explain to you, he worked 10 years with the U.S. military in Afghanistan to fight against the Taliban. He was taking food and eating it before our U.S. military were to make sure it was safe and not poisoned. So he was putting himself at risk and drinking and eating food to make sure it was safe before our own U.S. military would proceed to eat their meal. He was entering into shacks and areas of danger before the U.S. military, and so he's now here as a refugee, but he was fighting for the U.S. and to try to eradicate some of these terrorist groups. His family received numerous threats, and that's why they were expedited to the United States, because he is, along with his five children and his wife, were put on hit lists because they were helping the U.S. government. They love their country, Afghanistan, but it's riddled with terrorists and violence, and they can no longer stay there. And they've expressed to me so many times how it's sad that these groups have come in and disrupted their homes that they've known their entire life.
Amber, you talked about the vetting process and that excruciatingly long wait that a lot of folks face. Part of the rationale behind the executive order was to figure out a way to move towards something called extreme vetting. Do anybody on the panel know what that looks like and if it's actually possible for vetting to be more extreme than it already is?
That's a word that I keep hearing, but nobody's actually explain what it means. I don't even know if they themselves know what it means. Refugees are the most vetted individual that come into the U.S. There are many other avenues that people are coming into the U.S. that aren't vetted quite as much or at all. Just to give you a couple, and I don't want to put a bad name on these individuals, that's not my point, but international students, people here on work visas, people who are paroled into the U.S. under parole programs. Those people are not receiving the amount of vetting that refugees are. And so I'm not really sure what extreme vetting means. I can't imagine that it'd be more extreme. I mean, these people
means
are
means keep the Boston bombers out of the country. Mm-hmm.
Well, we've been, so to give you some information, the U.S. has been resettling refugees since, in its current system, they've added additional screenings and practices along the way, but refugees have been resettled systematically in the United States since World War II, so it's not a new process. Here in Tulsa, we've been resettling refugees since the 1970s, and so for a refugee to have to go through 2 years of vetting that's very thorough, that coordinates with all of our intelligence agencies, I'm not sure, I mean, what practices they're trying to make stronger. From my own experience, we've not had a single incident here in Tulsa, and from my networking with others in the United States, they have not had any incidents with the families that they resettled. These are people with children. I see sometimes in the news that resettlement agencies are only resettling single men, which is not the case. Priority is given to children. They're the first priority. Second priority is single mothers with children. Third priority is families. So over 50% of the people that are coming to the United States are children, whether they have a parent or a relative that's already here, or they're unaccompanied, meaning they're coming alone and they don't have anyone to assist them. So I'm pretty confident in our U.S. government and our intelligence agencies that they're vetting the people appropriately. And there's a history of that to show that it's being done correctly.
There were a number of questions, not so much on refugees, but on the illegal immigration. One person, and I think this is a very honest question, and so I read it verbatim. Don't appreciate the feeling I'm a lesser Catholic because I support border control. Should the government differentiate, and how should we differentiate between legal and illegal or undocumented immigrants?
Okay, so if I could jump in on that one. You shouldn't feel lesser for wanting to have control of the borders. That's natural for any nation on earth would want to control its borders and discern who should come and who shouldn't come. As Catholics, we should, I think, believe in strong borders. And so what we want is, as Catholics, what we should want is not illegal immigration, but legal immigration. And if then we were to build a wall, let's say, or in other ways control the border, then what we would be looking for as a church would be to have a process by which people could come legally. And I think that's really what all of us are looking for, is to know who's coming, to choose who's coming, and to welcome them, knowing that they have been properly screened and are ready to build a better America, a greater America, and not to tear down that country, our country. And so it's exactly what we should be doing, yeah. Frustrating for me, I would say, to see, though, that the entire emphasis is only on the first part. Those three parts to Catholic social teaching are maintaining a border, respecting that all families should be allowed to thrive, and then welcoming those that we can, who cannot thrive in their home country. If we say that we want to control our borders, then we also should say that we want immigration reform, so that people who are able, not able to live a good life in their home country, some of them at least, can come here. We're not talking about all 65 million, we're talking 2% of the 25 million, and that's on a global redistribution, that's not all coming to the United States. And so we're really talking about a small number of people who would be coming to the United States. And I think that's what we should focus on. Not the Catholic Church does not advocate for just an open border policy where virtually everybody can come and there's no rules or anything like that. And so I'd like to stress that for sure.
Thank you. Does anyone on the panel or audience know of any news source which is, as much as possible, based on facts alone with opinions limited to the editorial page?
Silence. Almost a yes. 30 years ago, I could give you a few.
NPR.
Wall Street Journal.
You know, I would say that EWTN does have a weekly news program, and I don't have a television set, so I can't watch it, but I can see it on my iPad on through the internet. It's a one-hour weekly news broadcast, and it is really, I mean, it covers it from a Catholic angle. EWTN is a relatively conservative news channel, and so it would have that kind of bent if you want to put one on it. But I appreciate looking at a lot of different news sources, five or six or eight on the internet, and comparing those different news sources to see how they line up. So you can read the New York Times, and you can read EWTN, you can read NPR, AP. What really comes down to is taking five or six or seven news sources and kind of homogenizing that information and saying, okay, now instead of having one line, I've got two, three, four, five, six, and you get a full picture. If you're just going to like read something that's on your Facebook feed, then just don't even bother, because it's just not worth your time. If you want, though, to be informed, choose a number of sources. And I would say like Catholic News Service, EWTN, there's a number of places that you can get some balanced information.
Some of the foreign sources are good, too. Right. BBC, for example, free online. An important thing I didn't mention in response to the question on news, because if you've got five different sources you've paid for, that adds up. But you already are paying for all those sources as citizens, and you get them through the Tulsa Public Library. And so learn what is available to you at the public library. Magazines can be downloaded onto your electronically onto your iPad or whatever you use. There are lots of access points for free already available to you as a citizen.
And it is available through the database through TCCCL. The Economist is very good at just an international overview. Things that you would never know were going on, because the national, you know, the news sources we get here, just they don't care.
And The Economist is probably the premier global news magazine. So highly recommended in those sources. Thank you for bringing that up.
How can we individually, or as St. Mary's parishioners, best donate our money, time, etc. to help Tulsa's refugee programs?
I'd recommend Catholic charity.
Pretty self-serving question.
Yeah. I was an executive director.
I didn't write that question.
So this question brings up a rather obscure point of Islamic law. How can we dialogue with the Muslim community, given the Islamic doctrine of taqiyya, or lying to the infidel to advance Islam? Can I take that one first?
Sure, go for it.
Okay, so
can you repeat that?
How can we have a dialogue with the Muslim community given the established Islamic doctrine of taqiyya, or lying to the infidel to advance Islam? Taqiyya, so about 80-85% of the world's Muslims are Sunni. The remainder are mostly Shia. Taqiyya was established by Shia Muslims in a very particular time in order to lie to Sunni rulers when they were being persecuted by Sunnis. So it has little or nothing to do with lying to a non-Muslim, and even if it were, almost any Muslim you meet here in Tulsa is going to be Sunni unless they are Iranian. So in my view, it's not. Can you take it from there?
Sure. So taqiyya was established for if you're, you know, being persecuted in
army, by the army, you're captured, whatever. And so if they ask you to rescind your faith or to no longer believe in Allah, you're whatever and things like that. So that would be okay for you at that point to be able to say, to save your life, right? For you to be able to say, okay, I believe in X, Y, Z, right? And so in Islam, you know, there's many, many rules that we go by. And one of the most important ones, which is one of the biggest sins, is lying, regardless of what it is, right? With the exception of saving your life. And so we hold that very dearly, right? And that word infidel just drives me crazy. And so for people to understand what infidel means, infidel was actually, again, back in the day when Prophet Muhammad and his followers in Mecca were being persecuted by pagans, right, which are anti-theists, not atheists, but anti-theists. So those who are against God, against religion, right? And so those were the ones that were referred to as infidels, right? And so for people to say that anybody that's not a Muslim is an infidel is just utterly ridiculous, because in the Quran, in multiple places, it mentions about the people of the book. So the people of the book are the Christians, the Jews, and the Muslims, right? And then it goes on to talk about other people and how you're supposed to treat people. And so, again, as a Muslim who was born and bred as a Muslim and follows her faith pretty closely, for me to have a very open dialogue with several people who are in the audience here, who are friends of mine, you know, that would be just ludicrous for them to say, oh, how are you supposed to have open dialogue because I'm just supposed to lie to you? So
how do you define infidel? What is your definition of infidel?
So like I said just a second ago, the definition of infidel was back in the day. Today, I don't even use that word. I would never even use that word, an infidel.
But it's not, it is in the, your Quran, is it not?
Again, it was written in the context when it was back then, thousands of years ago, not in this context.
So it's a non-word today in your estimation?
For most Muslims, no, it's not. For those that are, I don't want to say conservative, but those that are extremists, right, who use that word, that's on them. But as a Muslim, for me to pass any kind of judgment on anybody is a huge sin. So no, I would never ever use that word. And I would tell you at least 95% of the people that I know here that are Muslims would never ever use that word. And also to let you know about the Shia population here, there are many Shias here as well. Yes, there's two separate Shia organizations here. Yes, there is a Persian Shia population, but some of my best friends are actually Lebanese Shia, there's Syrian Shia, there's Iraqi Shia, there's Egyptian Shia, so there's lots of Shias here. And for people to think that in the news that you see Muslims or Sunnis and Shias are killing each other, no, again, that's ludicrous. And so we get along great. Some of my best friends are Shia. So that would be my definition to you. It's not a word that I've put in my vocabulary. As a Muslim, I would never put that in my vocabulary.
If we were to go back to the original question,
sure.
Say it again, Charles.
Yeah. How can we have a dialogue with the Muslim community under the given the doctrine of Taqiyya?
Okay, so that's a new word to me, so I'm learning also. In the Christian context, I would say something that's similar would be that we know that we have to speak the truth, right? It's one of the commandments. We shall not bear false witness. But that's not absolute. And so if you are, if you're a Catholic living in Germany in 1939 or 1942, and the Germans walk up, you're hiding some Jews in your attic, the Germans walk up and say, you have Jews in your attic. Well, what's the truth? Yes, you do, right? Are you compelled to tell them that? No, you're not compelled to tell them that. They don't have a right to know that because they're only asking so that they can harm another human being. And so you can say to the German, no, I don't have Jews in the attic. And from a Catholic moral theology standpoint, you've not committed a sin because they didn't have a right to ask that question to begin with. If you were to walk up to Father Jack and say, hey, my husband was just in the confessional, has he been committing adultery?
Poor Father Jack.
You don't have a right to know that. It's at the seal of confession. And so there are certain things, there are certain instances where speaking the truth is not the highest value. Protecting the life of that innocent Jew in the attic is a higher value than speaking the truth in that instance. And so somebody could say, well, then all you Catholics are liars. No, that's not true. That's not true. And so we always have to contextualize any kind of statement or code. And I can't speak to this one because I don't know anything about it.
You're absolutely correct.
But that's how I would kind of envision it playing out in a Christian sense.
Yes.
This is actually a good segue into the next question. I mean, since there is both a lot of lack of knowledge, misknowledge, however you want to put it, what opportunities are there in Tulsa to learn more about Islam? Is there anything like a lecture series or any good books to recommend?
Sure. So the Islamic Society of Tulsa hosts classes. They're 4-week-long classes, and they're free, and they're Wednesday evenings. They start at 7:30, and they serve pizza and things like that, and they go over the basics of Islam. At any point in time, you can call the mosque, and you can have a tour. You can speak with me. You can speak with anybody in the community. I mean, just go to an IHOP, go to a Bill and Bruce. I mean, go to multiple places here in town. Go to Tiamo's. All of their owners are Muslims, right? You probably brush up with Muslims every single day, and you don't even know it. So I would just say, hey, if you see somebody, your neighbor, I'm sure there's plenty of Muslims in your neighborhood. You know, just speak with anybody, and they'd be willing to sit down and speak with you and have dialogue with you.
Two questions on this one. From what nations, if there were a list of nations that Catholic Charities is resettling in Tulsa? Do you have them all alphabetized?
No, I don't have them all alphabetized. I can tell you currently the majority of the refugees we're serving are coming from Burma. About 90% of our caseload is from Burma, and that's been the case for the last 5 to 10 years. We are also seeing a resurgence in Ukrainian and Russian-speaking populations with what's going on in eastern Ukraine. We are also resettling, probably our third largest group is Iraqis, and those are individuals that have had some interaction with the U.S. military. And then we have just...
So are all, pretty much all the Iraqis are SIV?
Mm-hmm.
So, special immigrant visas. So they were people that the U.S. government, the U.S. military typically, would say that we want to get this guy out of this country, just like Mohammed. And so they're not applicants based on family relationship status, typically. They're people that some army officer says, this guy saved my life like 15 times, and I want to get this guy a golden ticket. And then they work overtime to get that taken care of. We did have SIV cases. Well, no, he made it in, right? He was the last guy in. You know, SIV cases, special immigrant visa cases, are also subject to the executive order. And so you could be an Iraqi interpreter for the U.S. military that captain really busted his chops to get this guy a golden ticket. And the executive order says, tough luck, guy, you're going to stay for 4 months in Iraq. 4 months is a long time to be in Iraq when somebody's trying to kill you. And you've risked your life for the U.S. government. And the U.S. government says, we're going to take care of you and we're going to get you out. A lot of people have indicated to me that as veterans of the Vietnam era, being in country in Vietnam, a lot of Vietnamese really risked their lives for U.S. soldiers. And they felt terribly guilty when they left, knowing that many of them would be left to the North Vietnamese and very poor treatment. When we go in, people trust us as a nation, and they should, because we're a great nation. But we should also make good on our promises. So if we tell somebody, you just got the golden ticket, we should stick that guy on an airplane and bring him to this country. We should not say, well, we changed our mind. Well, maybe we'll see you in 4 months, maybe we won't. That's just not something that I think we should allow to take place for these SIV cases.
What is Catholic Charities doing to keep together families where some members are in the country legally and some are not?
What are we doing? We're feeding them, we're giving them drink and clothing. If somebody is illegally in the country, if someone's an undocumented or illegal immigrant, and they come to our immigration program, what we can do is sit down and do what we call a consultation with them, and it would be with an attorney or with a case manager, and see if there is a program that the federal government has defined that they could receive from relief from. So let's say they were a victim of human trafficking. They were brought into this country under the idea that they would be a nanny or something like that, but it turns out, instead of doing that, they force them into prostitution. That person is an illegal immigrant by definition. They did not come legally into the United States. That person may have had two children, and those two children are U.S. citizens because they were born in America. We would sit down with that human trafficking victim and say, you're an illegal immigrant, but there's a program that we can enroll you in where the federal government says, we want to recognize the pain and suffering that you've had. We're going to document your case. We're going to represent you in court. And they will hear your case, and the federal government will judge. And if they choose to accept you, then you'll have a change in status. If they don't choose to accept you, then you'll try and find places where people could fit into the federal system to receive relief. If they're not eligible, they're not eligible. And so we serve about 1,000 people in our immigration office a year, a little more than that, 1,200 maybe this last year. But we receive maybe as many as 6,000 phone calls. And so we're serving maybe 20% of the people who call, because the rest, many of them, they're just as difficult for them. Another case would be if you're in the DACA case, would be probably the other prime example. And that's deferred action for childhood arrivals. And so what would happen there is that you have illegal parents who came across the border, and they brought with them their five-year-old son. Well, fast forward 15 years, that's now a 20-year-old son. His parents may never have told him that he was brought across the border illegally, or maybe they have. Probably they haven't, though, oftentimes. And so now he's graduated from high school, and he's trying to get like a Stafford loan to go to college. And sure enough, he finds out he's actually illegal. And so he's now scared, you know, because he never knew that. He only knows English. He only went to an American school, all the rest. The parents are probably culpable because they came across the border in violation of our law. The child, the five-year-old, I think has less culpability. He didn't freely choose to come across the border. He didn't know what he was doing. He wasn't capable of saying no. And so the federal government has created a program called Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals. If you were 5 years old, your parents brought you here, and you were brought up and you have a GED or you're working on you have a high school diploma, there's four or five different, you're in college, there's five or six different categories, you can apply, and for 2 to 3 years, we'll give you the ability to stay here and continue your education or to work. It is not a path to citizenship. It is not, it's really not a very good deal, to be honest, for that person, because it expires in 2 or 3 years and they get very little rights out of it. But it allows them to come out of the shadows so that they can live openly. The U.S. government knows who they are and they've chosen them. And now they can pursue a part of, you know, the American dream, which is all they ever thought they were going to do anyway. They really never realized what was going on in their own life.
But it also provides the child to petition for the parents to become U.S. citizens.
Well, it doesn't really, not on the DACA case, and I'll explain that. So in a DACA case, it's just deferred action. So they are not citizens. They are not on a path to citizenship. In 2 or 3 years, their DACA authorization expires. They can reapply if they would like to, and the federal government will then reevaluate their case and say, you know, you got a DUI while you were on your DACA time period. We're not going to renew you. You know, they don't have to renew them, and they don't renew a lot of them. And in fact, President Obama deported more illegal immigrants than all the other presidents in the previous administrations almost combined. So he was very, very heavy on deportation. In order to petition for your parents, you need to have a stronger legal status than a DACA permit. And so if you are an American citizen, which none of the DACA cases are not U.S. citizens, then they can't petition for their parents. If there are young people, though, who were born in the United States, so let's say he came over as a five-year-old, and then his little sister was born in Tulsa, she's a U.S. citizen by birth. She can run for president if she wants to. And that person potentially could petition. But I can tell you right now, those parents have got a long road, because being in the United States illegally is like the last category of people who are going to get authorization to stay. What they would probably have to do is to return to their home country and apply through the consulate in their home country, the U.S. consulate in their home country. So we do deal with consular affairs issues as well, where someone would have, we get lots of employers who call. You know, you'll have a company call and say, I found out that this guy's illegal. He's one of my best employees. I'll pay $10,000 for your attorneys to represent this guy. I don't want him to go home. And we can sit down and do a consultation. If there's a program that the federal government would allow that person to stay, we'll help them. If there isn't, there isn't. And so that's where we work within the confines of the government rules. And we would advocate for reform of those rules to allow some people, not all people, but some people, access to this country, because we think they will help make this country great, not because they will come and detract from it.
On the same issue of childhood arrivals, if you were settling unaccompanied minors without relatives here, how do the children live after arriving? Or do you settle unaccompanied minors without relatives?
We've resettled a couple. Some of our staff have had to fly to New York to meet the child and then travel to Tulsa with them. They either have an extended relative here who then we help with adoption or guardianship proceedings once they've arrived. We're not a program in Tulsa that is established to accept a lot of unaccompanied minors. I think the closest agency that does that is Fort Worth. And they have an entire building that's reserved for unaccompanied minors, and they have house parents that can oversee four or five children at a time in each little kind of unit.
It's like a foster care.
Yeah, a housing unit. But we've had a couple in the last 5 to 7 years, but not too often.
Generally speaking, we are only dealing with family reunification cases in Tulsa, and that's just by our own designation of what we feel we're capable of. And so if there's just a one-off case where it's like, hey, here's this guy from the Congo, and we're going to send him to Tulsa, we would say that guy's going to have a very hard time fitting in, because there's no one to really step through all the process of getting into a new life. What we want is a good family base, their brother, their mom, the son, whatever, to be there for them, to make sure that they're going to integrate into our lifestyle and our way of living very easily. And so we pretty much focus on family reunification.
Another tough one. I think this is the last really hard one. According to USAspending.gov, the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops has received $90 million for refugee resettlement in fiscal 2016, and Catholic Charities received $200 million. Is the interest of Catholic Charities primarily pecuniary, given those amounts?
Yeah. Catholic Charities in Tulsa has about an $8 million audit. You're welcome to look at it. You just call up, and I'll send it to you if you'd like. And it's actually a guy from St. Mary's who does our audit. I'll have to think of his name in a second. But of that, about a little bit less than 10%, it's like $600,000. Would you say that's right? $700,000 is dedicated towards refugee services. And that is, you could divide it in half. So if you have $700,000, half of that money, $350,000, goes directly to the client, goes directly to the refugee who comes to help them get into their apartment. You know, it pays their first month's apartment, it helps to get them some work shoes so that they can go to work, some things like this. But it all goes directly to them. The other half, the $350,000, is used by Catholic Charities to buy a van to transport refugees to the health department and to get their kids enrolled in school and so forth. It also pays salaries of, it was 6.5 equivalent FTE. With the pause, that's going on right now. We're scaling back to 3 employees. And so, you know, I mean, there is gain, I suppose, in that we receive funding to hire employees that will help the refugees. But if that program goes away, if President Trump were to say we want to go from 110,000 to zero, which I think he probably could do, it's a part of the executive branch to decide how many refugees come in. Poor Amber here would be out of a job, or we'd find another one for within the organization. But it does not, that funding does not fuse out into our food program, into our dental clinic, into our education program, into Madonna House, the St. Elizabeth's Lodge. It's completely sequestered or segregated for the refugee program. And we pretty much break even, which Amber gets kind of feisty about because she thinks we should spend more. I mean, that's just the answer. I don't know if that's what you
mean. I love this question. There's this kind of misconception that our program is
a moneymaker.
Yeah, a moneymaker, which I laugh hysterically because when I see my staff working 15 and 16 hours and they're getting paid like $10 an hour or something. It's not the case. The U.S. government's ratio for a case manager doing refugee resettlement is 75 people to one case manager. So if you could imagine helping 75 individuals who don't speak your language, who don't have a car or a telephone, who aren't familiar with our cultural customs, and you are in charge of those 75, and they're alone in the city, and they might not know anyone, that is definitely not a moneymaker. There's a lot of long hours and a lot of donations and from the community that help us. It's definitely not a moneymaker.
There's a lot of other organizations that actually put a lot of time and talent into it as well. So the school systems have really worked hard to bring people up to grade level quickly. The health department has really worked hard to make sure that everyone who comes does not have a communicable disease. So, you know, we want to make sure that we don't land somebody and then have them send their kids to school and they've got TB and all of a sudden we're on the news because, you know, we shut down an elementary school or something like that. We take it all very, very seriously, and we're very thorough in our processes, and we've never had a TB case. You know, we've never had a refugee who's never driven a car across the center line and kill a family. We've never had, I mean, you go down the list of all the fears that we might have. Our staff has been very, very dedicated at making sure that this is very successful. And that's not this year. That's over a 40-year time frame. That's Bishop Condola, that's Bishop Slattery, that's Bishop Beltran, who was that? Bishop Ganter. I mean, this goes way back. This is a staple program of Catholic Charities, a staple program of the Bishops' Conference since the mid-1970s when the Vietnamese boat people came over.
I love this question. I'm the kind of Catholic who would wear a hijab in solidarity, but I wouldn't want to offend.
Where do you buy them at?
This is Kevin's question, actually.
Amazon.com?
That's
yeah.
Right, Amazon Dillard's.
would that be okay?
That would be perfectly fine. I mean, just like Deacon Kevin mentioned before, I mean, Catholic women who go into church, they put a veil on. Jewish women, they wear, you know, headscarves. Sikh men and women, you know, cover their hair. So, I mean, if you wanted to be in solidarity, that would be perfectly fine. I would just, you know, hope that you wouldn't quite literally put a target on your head, you know, to be in solidarity with us, because unfortunately, that is what you're doing. I love that you want to do that in solidarity. But again, out of my concern for your safety, I wouldn't want you to do that for safety purposes. So,
you know, one last thing, if I could throw in on that a little bit, I've dominated too much, I know already, but if you were to take this to the worst fear that you've got, or that all of us could have, it would be that somebody would walk in here right now and yell out some phrase and blow up a bomb, right, and we're all dead. Is that, You know, I mean, that could be the worst thing that could happen to us, I guess. Mm-hmm. And that person was a refugee from Catholic Charities. Good job, Amber. Good job. That would be the worst fear that we might have. But I would say that that isn't the worst fear. That's not the worst thing that could happen. One of the things that we're celebrating this year is the martyrdom and the beatification of Father Stanley Rother. For his faith, he gave up his life to serve others, and he did so fearlessly. He said, I'm going to love, and if they take my life because of that, so be it. And now he'll be remembered for all eternity as one of the saints in heaven. Next week, there's probably Sunday that's a green day on the calendar, which means it's just another day in ordinary time. And it's waiting for some saint to be named so that that can be Saint Bob, you know? Wouldn't it be great, and I'm getting ridiculous here, right? Wouldn't it be great if we could all be martyred and be known as the saints of Tulsa collectively, kind of like a gift in a way? What really would be the worst thing that could happen to us would be for us to close our hearts and to be absolutely cold and indifferent to the suffering of other people and just say, to hell with you guys. Because that will come back on us. We're given a gift and the privilege of being able to serve others. And if we do it well, then maybe one day we too will be saints, yeah? So let's work that direction.
Wow, that's beautiful.
That's why he's the deacon.
Yeah. That's why he makes the big bucks.
Right? All right.
That's true. Such a holy man.
So this is going to be our last question. So before I ask it, I want to thank all of our panels, Deacon Kevin, Amber, Aliye, Mayor Randle. I thank all of you all for being here. Staff of St. Mary's, Father Jack, Mike, Jake, everybody. Thank you. Everybody, round of applause. Final question, is there anything practical we can do to make refugees feel welcome? Can I volunteer to be a friend?
Yes. Yes. We want all of you.
That's a softball.
I always say the best way to tackle these issues of indifference, are to meet people and to have a conversation with them. Most people that I encounter in the community that have kind of some hatred or are not welcoming views typically don't even know a person of Islam or a Muslim person. And so I always, when I encounter these people, invite them to come along with me through my day at work. And I guarantee that if you have somebody who has these kind of indifferent views, they will leave a changed person just one day. I've invited several people to come to home visits with me to my Muslim families, and they sit down, and the hospitality that we encounter when we go to a home visit is just out of this world. I always tell my American friends, we could learn a thing or two from somebody from Iraq or Syria. Because when I go to their house to conduct my federally required home visit, they have a 5-course meal prepared for me and tea, and we sit there and we have beautiful conversation, and they share their stories of struggle and their stories of hope for being in the U.S. And those are the stories that are not being heard enough. And so anybody who's wanting to get contact with a client and learn more, we really encourage people to come and volunteer their time and to see how the program actually is working rather than what you're hearing in the news. I think you'll be pleasantly surprised.
Again, thank you all so much for being here. Father Jack would like to... So again, I echo with Charles for a panelist. Thank you so much for making time. Thank you to Kelly and the young adults for organizing everything. They set everything up. They planned everything. You know what Deacon Kevin said at the end, you know, when he was talking about
Stanley wrote her and giving her, giving our lives and if we closed our hearts. It was really beautiful. I thought, well, at that point, if we all died, if something happened, we were blown up or whatever, the feast day would be listed St. Kevin Sartorius and Companions. We wouldn't get any credit. It was beautiful. Really, it's, I think,
it's
typically it's a lack of information, we don't have understanding, a lack of understanding that it really provides a lack of charity. And so we're here to understand, to open our minds, but really to open our hearts, for us as Christians, the command of Christ, to really allow the Lord to continue to transform us. So again, I thank you for your part in being here, and so maybe we'll close in prayer. Good and gracious God, we thank you for your many blessings. We trust your divine providence in our lives. We ask that you would always keep us open in mind and heart. Pray that we might be a people of charity and service. May our lives be defined by the love we show others. Guide us always in discerning your will. We need this prayer in God's holy name.
Amen. Amen.